Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Vedanta Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. A victorious Krishna, Sri Krishna Vijay. This book was compiled by Gunarat Jakal, who is an associate. Sri Gunarat Jakal was one of the topmost Vaishnavas, and he translated the 10th and 11th cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam for the understanding of the common man. The book Sri Krishna Vijay was highly praised by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and is very valuable for all Vaishnavas. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave a genealogical table and family history of Gunaraja Khan. When a Bengali emperor named Adisura first came from Ganjakubja or Kanauj, he brought with him 5 brahmanas and 5 kayastas. Since the king is supposed to be accompanied by his associates, the brahmanas accompanied the king to help him in higher spiritual matters. The kayastas were to render other services. In the northern Indian high country, the kayastas are accepted as sudras. But in Bengal, the kayastas are considered amongst the higher castes. It is a fact that the kayastas came to Bengal from northern India, especially from Kanjagupta or Kanauj. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur says that the kayastas who came from Kanjagupta were high-class men. Of them, Dasharatha Vasu was a great personality, and the 13th generation of the family included Gunaraja Khan. His real name was Maladharu Vasu, but the title Khan was given to him by the Emperor of Bengal. Thus he became known as Gunaraja Khan. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati gives the following genealogical table of Gunaraja Khan. Dasharatha Vasu Kushala, Shupashankara Hansa Shaktiram, Muktiram and Alankara Damodar Anantaram. Gunin Vinayaka and Vinanayaka. The 12th generation included Bhagiratha, and the 13th Maladharavasu or Gunaraja Khan. Sri Gunaraja Khan had 14 sons, of whom the second son, Lakshminatavasu, received the title Satyaraja Khan. His son was Ramanandavasu, therefore Ramanandavasu belongs to the 15th generation. Gunaraja Khan was very well known and wealthy man. His palace, fort and temples are still existing. And from these one can deduce that the opulence of Gunaraja Khan was certainly very great. Sri Gunaraja Khan never cared for the artificial aristocracy introduced by Balasena. Sri Maladharavasu Gunaraja Khan was a great devotee of the Lord who desired greatly to benefit the world with his rendition of this account of the pastimes of the Lord. Thus, throughout the book are found the blessings he bestows on the readers of his book. While narrating the Lord's pastime, he inserted his own teachings of the absolute truth that separates reality from illusion. The reader will thus enjoy the benefits of hearing the account of the pastimes of the Lord, at the same time hear the philosophy of the absolute truth. Sri Krishna Vijay mainly deals with the subject matters described in the 10th and 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. He also includes some accounts from scriptures like Mahabharata, Harivansa, Brahmavagata, Purana, and Bhavishya Purana. Additionally, he revealed at the end of the book that he was actually inspired by Sri Vyasadeva in his dream to compose this book. One prayer is that this book is accepted by the devotees of the Lord and that they bless us so we may continue presenting literature such as this to the world. Om namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Bandeham Sri Gurum Sita Parakamalam Sri Gurum Vaishnavam Sisha Sri Rupam Sagrayatam Sahagna Ragunatan Vitam Tam Sajivam Satvetam Samatutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sagana Lalita Shiva Shakandita Karoti Vachalam Pagum Lankayati Yat Kripa Tamaham Bandesh Guru Tivatar. Thank you. a story about our Queen Rukmini. Rukmini thought deeply for a long while and was extremely disappointed upon learning that she was to marry Shishupal. She almost lost her external consciousness. She breathed heavily and lamented profusely. Oh Lord Hari, I'm really disappointed. I have heard about Krishna since my childhood. In order to get Krishna as my husband, I have been worshipping Shiva and Parvati with devotion. Krishna is the Lord of everyone and is therefore the only suitable husband for me. Yet my father thinks otherwise. He has now found someone else to be my husband. If I meditate on his lotus feet, on the lotus feet of Goddess Chandi with undivided attention, then I will certainly succeed in my attempt to have the lotus eyed Krishna as my husband. Rukmini Devi then pacified her mind to some extent. She then secretly called an old and trusted Brahmin. Offering her obeisances, she said, "O respected one, please take this message and go to Dwaraka to give it to Krishna. Tell him about my impending marriage to Shishupal and everything else. I've heard from people that Krishna is worshipped through the world. He's very attractive and his beauty enchants even Cupid. All the women of the world are bewildered by his beauty. The lotus-eyed Lord is the essence of the universe. He is none different from Lord Narayan, and I have accepted him as my only husband. I have surrendered my body, mind, and speech to him. I do not know why my father wants me to marry someone else. I have tried my best to convince him, but it is of no use. O Brahmana, go quickly and tell Krishna to kidnap me. If he asks how he can do that in the midst of all the kings, tell him that there is a way to do it. In my family tradition, there's a custom that the bride should visit the temple of Goddess Durga on the day before her marriage. So when I go to worship Goddess Chandi in the company of my friends, my Lord Damodar should then take me away by force. O Brahmana, do not waste any more time. Go and bring my Lord Krishna as soon as possible." So this is a very beautiful story of a beautiful girl, a Queen Rukmini, and she don't want to get married to King Shishupal. That is the subject here. And on top of that, she has made up her mind to marry Lord Krishna. Well, you know, in the Krishna conscious movement, our goal is to please Lord Krishna. And to please Lord Krishna in the position of his queen, that is called Swakiya Bhava. Swakiya is the marriage relationship with the Supreme. And that is glorified as a great accomplishment. Greatest accomplishment. So our dear Rukmini makes Krishna an invitation. Please kidnap me. So this is very nice to see how Queen Rukmini makes the whole plan for her own kidnapping. The Brahmana messengers goes to Dwaraka. Being thus ordered by Queen Rukmini, the Brahmana immediately left for Dwaraka in search of the Lord of the Three Worlds. There are no restrictions for Brahmanas to move freely in the boat of Krishna. Therefore the Brahmana quickly crossed all barriers, ditches and gates and arrived at the palace to find Lord Krishna sitting on his throne. As soon as the Brahmana approached Lord Krishna, quickly Krishna stood up and respectfully making the Brahmana sit down comfortably on the cold couch. After satisfying the Brahmana in every way, Krishna inquired, "O Brahmana, where do you live? What brings you here? Have you been insulted by your king or his man? Does your king treat everyone equally?" The Brahmana, who was merely relaxed by now, replied, "I've brought a secret message for you. Noble-hearted Bhishmaka, the king of Vidarbha, has a beautiful daughter named Rukmini. She's charming like Parvati and equals Lakshmi in qualities. She has chosen you as her only husband. Her body, mind, and speech are fully dedicated to you. She thinks of no one but you as her husband. In every way, she's qualified right for you. Her father agreed to give her hand in marriage to King Shishupal at the request of his son Rukmini. Oh Lord, tomorrow is the date of the marriage. Please go to Vidarbha at once and do something about it. If you are neglectful and do not go, then she said she will give up her life while thinking about you." When Krishna heard these words of the Brahmanas, he immediately decided to go to Vidarbha and save his would-be queen Rukmini. "Rukmini eternally belongs to me. I'm her only suitable husband. Who other than I can marry her?" Krishna contemplated in this way as he prepared to leave for Vidarbha. Krishna received the Brahmanas. They could just go in and out of his palace. They were his trusted Brahmanas. So, and he received them with so much affection. One more thing about Lord Krishna. He is always open to all those who serve from the heart. His palace, his heart. Now Krishna says, "I'm in the heart of my devotee and the devotee is in my heart." That is an incredible information. The Lord says, "The devotee is in my heart, and I'm in the heart of the devotee." Such a wonderful thing. Then you can hear the Harinam parties going from one place to the other. This is still a big parikrama times. Krishna then assured the Brahmana, "I will go to Vidarbha at once and kidnap Rukmini, O crest jewel amongst the Brahmanas. I give you my word that I will certainly marry Rukmini." Thereafter, Krishna ordered his servant Daruka to arrange his chariot quickly. When the charioteer brought the chariot, Krishna immediately mounted it with the Brahmana and started towards the city of Vidarbha. Oh, he even got to ride on Krishna's chariot. Lucky, the Brahmana, no? Take a ride with Krishna on the chariot. How many people you know Krishna has taken on his chariot? Arjuna. Meanwhile, Bhishmaka began to perform the rituals performed on the day before marriage ceremony. His family priest conducted different devotional procedures to satisfy his worshipable lord. The king gave away many gifts and wealth in charity. He invited all the inhabitants of Vidarbha to participate in that ceremony. People came and enjoyed to their full satisfaction, dancing and singing. The whole city was joyful. So this is something Indian marriage. Ah, everybody has to be happy. Somebody gets married, those who organize the marriage, they like to invite the whole village. And if they're rich, they do anything to make my daughter gets married. Oh, this is the big festival. And they can feed. And you know, many people, they don't want to give you 5 paisa. Very stingy. But when comes the marriage time, they spend lakhs and lakhs of rupees for everybody to be happy about the marriage. I've seen it personally. I've seen people spending crores of rupees on the marriage. So it is true, and it is even going on today. So whole of Vidarbha was feasting for the marriage of Shishupal and Rukmini. So can you imagine, the whole city was in the mood. On the other side, the king of Chedi also performed the necessary rituals for the marriage of his son Shishupal. He invited many qualified brahmanas and had them conduct the ceremonies properly. Early in the morning on the day before the marriage, Damagosha had his son take a special bath and perform different auspicious rituals for his benefit. When Rukmini saw and heard all these developments, she began to cry profusely. Oh my God. She fixed her mind on Krishna and lamented, "Alas, why has the Creator made such a fate for me? I belong to Krishna. How can Shishupal marry Krishna's queen? Even though I worshipped Shiva and Parvati with love and devotion, still I could not attain the favor of Lord Narayan. I must be very ugly. That is why the son of Nanda has not come." Ah, Krishna. Perhaps he does not like me. Maybe my Brahmana messenger could not reach Dwaraka in time. Maybe he's stuck somewhere on the way. Maybe Krishna hasn't got my message. Why has the Lord of my heart not come to marry me? Oh, Hari, I'm still alive. I'm still alive. I belong to the lion and not to the jackal. While lamenting in this way, Rukmini lost her external consciousness and fell to the ground, murmuring, "Let me die, let me die." Meanwhile, as Krishna left on his chariot for Vidarbha, Baladeva started to feel somewhat worried. He immediately understood that was what was going to happen. He realized that Krishna had left to kidnap Rukmini from the assembly of many different kings. Thinking that Krishna was all alone, Balarama took Chada, Satyaki and a large number of soldiers and followed Krishna to the city of Vidarbha. After some time, the two brothers, Rama and Krishna, met up with each other in the city of Vidarbha. A messenger immediately went and informed the king of their arrival. Upon hearing the news, the king immediately came out of the palace and respectfully greeted Rama and Damodar. He worshipped them with devotion and offered them comfortable seats. When Jarasandha, who was sitting in that assembly, saw Krishna and Balaram, he bent his head in anger and began to contemplate. "These two fellows are here again? I attacked the city of Mathura with 23 Akshauhini divisions of soldiers, But these two brothers, though they were only small boys, defeated us easily. I could not stand before them and had to leave the battlefield. And now these two brothers are here and most probably will take away Rukmini, just as a lion takes away its booty from the grip of a jackal. So Jarasandha had some realizations, no? He could understand there is something going on here, no? He had the vision. After thinking in this way, Jarasandha thought it wise to speak to King Bhishmaka. O king, you are old and experienced. You are very respectable. Therefore, we tolerate all your misbehavior. We are ashamed to tell you that you have invited to these ordinary coward boys in the assembly of great kings and warriors like us. This Krishna played some trick and killed Kamsa, and foolish people glorify him without knowing anything. He's really doing politics, no? Nasty politics. That's how nasty politics are. People just make up terrible stories and invent things, no? He runs away from the battlefield because he's afraid to face powerful warriors. Nowadays, he lives within the ocean in the company of the Chandalas. How dare you invite such a low-class fellow to this assembly? You are worshipping the servant instead of the masters. We will not stay here any longer. We will return home. If you wish, you may marry your daughter to this coward boy. When Rukmini's father, King Bhishmaka, heard the blasphemy against Krishna, he became extremely pained in the heart. He lowered his head in shame and did not utter a word. Then the two great kings named Krata and Kaushika embraced Krishna and Balaram with great affection. They performed Abhisheka to Krishna by pouring upon him waters from different holy rivers. King Krata held an umbrella above Krishna's head, while King Kaushika fanned Krishna with a chamara. In this way, Krishna was officially installed as the king of Vidarbha. Indra performs Abhisheka to Krishna. Just then, Indra, the king of heaven, and his wife Sachi Devi arrived and began to perform Abhisheka to Krishna with the milk from the Surabhi cow. After duly performing the ceremony, Indra enthroned Krishna as the king of kings. Sachi Devi, along with her many celestial women, worshipped and glorified Krishna with auspicious songs. In this way, after worshipping Krishna and showering flowers upon Krishna and Balaram, Indra returned to his own abode. Being very happy, the demigods and the heavenly planets wonder at seeing Krishna's influence and promise. All the assembled kings became frightened and said with their head lowered, "Bode, you, human beings, hear Sri Krishna Vijay attentively as Munaraja Khan narrates Krishna's pastimes. After being enthroned as king, Krishna appeared like a lion in the midst of elephants. In the meantime, Rukmini Devi began to make preparation to worship goddess Chandika. She was surrounded by female dancers, singers, wife of the Brahmins, and so on. There were many musical instruments which made pleasant sounds as Rukmini sat down on a chariot to go to the temple. In the course of her journey, she simply remembered Krishna. After riding on the chariot for a while, she got down and started walking. Once inside the temple of Goddess Durga, she worshipped the goddess in the company of many chaste women by offering her various ingredients. She offered incense, ghee lamp, foodstuff, camphor, betel nut, and many other articles. At the end of her worship, she folded her hands and prayed, "O Goddess, I fall down at your feet. My only wish is that I may get the lotus-eyed Krishna as my husband. Please give me this benediction that Govinda will become my husband." Oh, she's insisting, isn't it? Huh? After worshipping Shiva and Durga with face and various ingredients, the beautiful Rukmini remembered Sri Hari as she prepared to leave the temple. Just then, she saw some auspicious signs. Her left thigh, left eye, and left arm all began to shake. Then she saw the old Brahmana messenger, who she had sent to Krishna. Rukmini hurriedly went before the Brahmana and said, "O Brahmana, has the Lord of my life come? Has my Lord Damodar arrived?" "Yes," the Brahmana replied, "Krishna has come. The crest jewel of all kings has arrived here. He's sitting in the assembly. Today, your life has become successful. For today, the lotus-eyed Krishna will become your husband." As soon as Rukmini, the enchantress of the universe, heard these words, she became so happy that she did not know what to give to the Brahmana to please him. Unable to find any suitable gift for the Brahmana, Rukmini felt very happy, but within her mind she felt extremely grateful to the Brahmana. So this is beautiful. As Rukmini slowly went to the Swayamvara area, she held a beautiful garland of jasmine flowers. Anyone who saw her became faint, being struck by her beauty. They were transfixed by the various parts of her body that happened to catch their glances. Just as the assembled kings stood spellbound and overwhelmed by Rukmini's beauty, Krishna suddenly arrived in his chariot and snatched Rukmini away from the vision of everyone, placing her on his left side. Krishna drove his chariot away, roaring like a lion. Lord Govinda went first with Rukmini. And then Lord Balaram followed with a huge army. When the assembled kings saw Krishna kidnap Rukmini, they became very angry and chased after him, brandishing various weapons. First amongst them were Rukmi and Shishupal, followed by Jarasandha with his vast army. They exclaimed, "You coward, what are you doing? Where are you going? You are like a deer in the midst of the lions. Don't run away. If you have guts, then stand and fight." Krishna and Balaram accepted their challenge and halted their journey. Balaram, along with the same of the army, fought vigorously with the kings. In great anger, shame, and frustration, Shishupal also aimed his arrows towards Krishna and Balaram. But before he could shoot his arrows, Balai cut his bow into three pieces by shooting three arrows from his own bow. When Shishupal again took up another bow, Balaram broke it into pieces once more. Jarasandha addressed his fellow various kings. "O kings, quit fighting. There's no point fighting with this useless fellow. If we are defeated, we will be greatly ashamed. They have a vast army and Garuda is also with them, so it is very difficult for us to defeat them now. Moreover, the time is not quite ripe for us to kill the two brothers. When the right time comes, we will certainly destroy them." Hearing Jarasandha speak like this, all the dejected kings began to retreat. Rukmini, however, refused to quit. So Rukmini's brother Rukmini was very upset. He didn't stop. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Bhagavanityananda, Shri Advaita Gadhara, Shivasa Vigola Bhaktarina. It is so beautiful that a soul can request Krishna to marry him. This is so beautiful to just see how Krishna makes all arrangements possible to reciprocate to his devotees' love. So in our bhakti movement, we are actually following in the footpaths of those who have the conjugal feelings for the Supreme Lord. These conjugal feelings are extremely auspicious and extremely elevated, and they have been glorified in the Rasa Leela, because the Rasa Leela is the Maharas, Mahabhav, Mahamantra, Mahamaha. Everything the greatest, the sweetest, that is found in Krishna Leela, and that is what has come to our attention by the grace of our Guru Varga. We cannot even imagine that we are actually able to read this account of Krishna kidnapping Rukmini so elegantly. Her call, her cry, her prayer, and even though her family, they were not very agreeable to the idea, but when they saw the might of Krishna's determination to marry Rukmini, then finally they all got the mercy. Whoever comes in contact with Krishna gets an unlimited amount of mercy. So if we are chanting our Maha Mantra every day, we are praying for this mercy. That is actually, oh my Lord, please let me be an instrument of your love. So what does it mean? I mean, of course, if Krishna wants you to be a Gopa, or he wants you to be anybody, or a Shaka, or a Das, Dasya Ras, whatever he wants. I mean, if you're a surrendered soul, you will simply want that what Krishna wants. But there is a certain charm in a certain degree of intimacy. That how this manifests, nobody can understand anything. But it is there. The Divine Leela is there, the six Goswamis of Vrindavan are there, and we have heard it from our Acharyas in so many different ways, how their enchantment for the Divine has absolutely no limits. So that is why Krishna book, now here in the case of Gunaraja Khan, is a testimony, it's a book of testimony. Testimony of feelings. So Gunaraja Khan's book was highly appreciated by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I actually didn't know that. That means it was written previous to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, obviously. And so the ever enchanting secret. Now, this is the most important thing, you know. Krishna is being propagated. Krishna is being promoted as the best of the husbands. And nowadays we have a movement of gentle girls and ladies around the world who are hearing this and they say, maybe I also want to marry Krishna. Maybe I don't want to marry anybody in this world of confusion and cheating on each other and all that. So there's a lot of deception going on in this world. So to choose Krishna over all this deception and say, no, I want to make Krishna the Lord of my heart. And that is now, I mean, in those days, Krishna had girls in love with him from Vidarbha, from Braj, from different places, all the kidnapped queens, which Krishna freed when he killed Balasura, and then they were also. And nowadays Krishna has aspiring queens of They are now all over the world, all the way from China to South America, in Alaska, in Russia. For you, I have no business here in Argentina and all that. So this is what is happening. It's an amazing thing. I mean, if you look from this point of view, no, there's many different takes you can take, but this is one take, because I mean, we are following the Rupa Goswami, and Rupa Goswami, Rupa Manjari, is some elevated concept and teaching of the greatest love glorification. So, and here we are, Jai Prabhupada. You give us this japa, you give us this mantra, you give us this idea, it's all your fault. You figure out what you're going to do with all that. With all this, like I sometimes wonder, you know, in our Vrinda mission we have so many wonderful girls and also boys, because in spiritual marriages we are not boys and girls, we are just Krishna's dasis. That's actually true, you know. A male vanity, it doesn't offer much, you know. So it's more safe to be a dasi. Huh? A dasi, dasi, dasi of the dasis, of Radharani, Radha Dasya. But this, this amazing promotion, I mean, if you consider Krishna, when everybody fell in love with him, he was a little boy. And besides that, Krishna, he came to this world 5,000 years ago. Now he's being worshipped in his deity form everywhere. And still this craving for this loving relationship in Madhurya Ras, it is existing, it is there. Wanting to marry Krishna, wanting to be with Krishna, wanting to serve Krishna unconditionally. Now, whatever it means, the Lord knows better. But it means now you can cook for him. What does a wife do for her husband? She cooks for him. She cleans. She arranges his dresses. She massages his feet with some oil, maybe. All this our devotees can do. Actually, I don't remember where I read it, but somewhere it says when you do puja to the Lord, like to Radha Madan Mohan, the personal puja, it is your third birth. Second birth, Gayatri Mantra, entering into the awareness of our spiritual life. But worshipping Thakurji, third birth. As in India, that was very restricted. Try to go into the Thakurji room of Radha Raman. They will tell you, take birth again in a Ram, into a Radha Raman. Pujari family and a male birth, no female birth, then you will be initiated, eventually you will be allowed to do this puja. Right? No way. No way you're going to get in there. But then comes Srila Prabhupada and says, come on, here is the Lord, now all of you worship him. Man, woman, everybody, let's fall in love with Krishna. This is the liberation of the divine love movement. All came by the revolutionary Lord Chaitanya, by the revolutionary Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, by the revolutionary Srila Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada. Can you just imagine? It is a reality. When you're chanting in Vrinda Bhumi with all the devotees in your meditation, here's another one of you. Here's another one of your surrendered souls. And you know the devotees are not bothering Krishna. At least we shouldn't. We say, you do whatever you want, but we are here to chant this prayer because this is the Mahabhav prayer. The Mahaprabhu give the Maharas Mahabhav prayer in the Mahamantra. So here I'm chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And everybody's ranting and raving and going mad with divine love. I mean, in a way, when you see this rocking kirtans go off, you know. I mean, it's not easy to enter into this divine realm of Bhav, but something keeps us going. What keeps you going is some Bhav as well. Faith, determination, I'm going to go to Suryakund and I'm going to worship Narayan. Lord Narayan, this wonderful Surya Narayan. What's that? That's the meeting place of Radha and Krishna. Every noontime, Krishna and Radha meets in Suryakund. So, it is such a connection between the supreme divine realm and our touchable realm. This is Gupta Vrindavan. This Mati is from the divine world. This Ganga is from the lotus feet of Trivikram. Everything is so connected. But we are still also disconnected because we think about Facebook, we think about the dress I will have, we think about what people think about me, and we get sidetracked easily, very easily. But in the end of it all, this whole drama all ends up in Krishna Loka, because there's no other place. Where you want to go? Want to go to Swarga? To hang around with the lusty, frustrated devas? Because they're also lusty and frustrated. Otherwise, they wouldn't end up being back, falling to the material world. What about? You want to go where? You want to become one of those Muslim sheikhs there? This fanatics? Huh? What do you want in this world? Or you want to go to the Patalas? And here in this world, anyway, it's all coming up and down, up and down. So what there? There's only one destiny, the realm of divine love. And that's what the Srimad Bhagavatam is advocating. Supreme Lord, supreme literature, and what is it telling about a queen falling in love with Krishna? She never even met him. She never even saw him. She just heard about him. Like you. You never met him. You just heard about him, but you were already worshipping his lotus feet. You were making dresses for Radha Madan Mohan. You were worshipping Radha Braja Mohan, Radha Brajaswara. You were worshipping Gorgalada. So all these things is real. With your own hands you do puja, with your own, you recite the mantras. What is the mantras? Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Atreita Gadadha Shiva Sadigoda Bhakti. Sometimes understanding, sometimes not understanding, but simply following the great path of devotion, the great path of divine love, because it's only divine love, everything else is madness. The world is full of madness, and it's not only madness, it's increasing madness. But in the middle of it, believe it or not, there is a movement developing and expanding, and it is called the movement of Sanatana Dharma. And that movement of Sanatana Dharma is further enhanced by the divine plan, which is the divine plan of Gauranga. Sanatana Dharma is one thing, and Gauranga Leela is another, even though they're totally connected with each other. But through Mahaprabhu, things happening, just like the Kirtan movement. I just came from the International Yoga Festival, and the high points of everything was the Kirtan. Everybody recognized. There was, they did some yoga asanas, and they had this twist and that twist on yoga, but the high point was when the Kirtan started. And they just touched it from the little piece on the side. But, I mean, when they really go mad dancing, like in the Kiva, like when Damodamar starts going off, you know, then they really, really, they lose their connection with this mundane world by the grace of the Kirtan. So what is the Kirtan movement doing? Changes us. Changes the world. Incredible potential in the Kirtan movement. That is why we are so grateful to be here. So grateful to be here in the holy Dham. Yes, we cannot understand much of it, that's a fact. And what will come from all of it? Well, we know death is certain, consciousness is certain, Jeev Shakti is certain, and divine Sambhog means the soul can meet with God. We are more recommended to go the way of Vipralamba, of feeling separation. It's more real, because that's where we are. We are separated. In a way, you're not, but more separated usually from our mind. I mean, if you worship Thakurji, you're not separated. When you chant the holy name of Krishna, you're not separated. When you read the Srimad Bhagavatam, you're not separated. When you taking prasadam, you're not separated. But still there's some vipralamba, pain. Oh my Lord, when will I be pure enough to be able to serve you, to be part of your divine plan? So in this way, our bhakti teachers have taught us this safe approach. Yes, I'm worshiping in Krishna. You want to come and kidnap me, that's good. Of course, Rukmini was pushy, no? She even said, I give up my life if you don't come. That's pretty pushy, no? She didn't give Krishna much of a choice. Because otherwise he would have been declared guilty for Rukmini losing her life in the pain of separation just after she heard about it. So I love this story of Rukmini and the kidnapping of Rukmini. It's one of my favorite stories because it gives you so much hope. Wow, Krishna's going through all that trouble, making all these incredible arrangements to snatch her right in the middle of the feast of the jackals. Comes the lion and takes this beautiful meaning to Ulokanaya. So this is what we are meditating upon today, you know. And Mahaprabhu, he has brought us this. He has brought us the Bhagavatam. He has brought us Srila Prabhupada. And this morning we were talking about the Bhagavad Gita. I mean, talking about physical work. Just physical work, not even considering spiritual. To produce a Bhagavad Gita is an unbelievable thing because nobody has done it. What to speak of getting it printed and distributed in 100 languages around the world. But Srila Prabhupada also gave us the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is an epic. This is for a single old man to do that. Inconceivable. Working at night when we go to sleep. And then in addition to throw in like a special little gift, Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is another huge, huge work. How did Prabhupada do that? I mean, look at all the big yogis. What did they give in literature? The famous yogis. Only Osho gave a lot of stuff which is all full of speculation. Which is not reliable. Totally unreliable stuff. I mean, the Shankaracharyas, they have not supplied us solid substance with encounters and defeating the Vaishnava point of view. They make some ambiguous statements and they make some, they chant their ambiguous mantra like Tatvam Asi or Soham, Soham. But even those mantras, they are not having any defeating power because they can be interpreted in the Vaishnava way just as well. Soham, I'm yours. So, definitely, It's an interesting thing. I had a discussion with the Shankaracharya on Rishikesh. And I asked him straight, so where do you get this from, that there's only Brahman in the end? Where do you get that from? I said, you have to accommodate that the scriptures, they speak about Goloka, they speak about Ayodhya, they speak about Vaikuntha, and about Shalokya, Sharti, Samipya, Sarupya, Katma. They speak about all that. So, how can you say that there are not such destinations when the Shastras giving ample accounts of it? But he was trying to evade me. He started changing the subject and talking with other people, other things, while we were in a discussion. But I didn't allow him. I said, Shankaracharya, please answer my question. And then I added, of course, I agree with you, Sajuja Mukti exists, but you can't say it's the highest, because who got Sajuja Mukti? Shishupal. When Krishna killed Shishupal after so offensive, then he got Sajuja Mukti. That's what's said in the Bhagavatam. He said, yes, it's true. So we have a different account here. At least we have to accommodate both ways. Anyhow, then the conversation was ended because he had to meet somebody else. But it was good. I mean, just grace to Srila Prabhupada, no? To meet one of the official Shankaracharyas that speak on this subject. No, I couldn't accomplish much. But at least we can feel confirmed again and again. Srila Prabhupada has given us, that is the Vedic truth. We received the Vedic truth, whether we can realize it or not, is another story. But we received the Vedic truth from the most extraordinary personality, the most chosen one. And there is an enigma. You know, Indians are very proud. Hey, Bharatavarsha, Jai Hind. We are the race of grace. This is India. Oh, my God. They're very... You watch them, RSS, you know? 30,000 kids. Bang! Yes, Jai Hind. Yes, India. Yes, Bharatamata Ki Jai. Woo! You can see they have it. What you call Subhashandras Bose and all these people. No? Let's fight for our nation, for our original tradition. That's interesting. But when it comes to Srila Prabhupada, they're very shy. Even though Prabhupada took the Sanatana Dharma out of India and distributed all over the world, even to that degree that people from the other world now coming here in devotional dresses. I mean, nobody else really does that. Nobody else. The yogis come here and doing a little few asanas and going back to their television life. It's not that they have had a permanent transformation with permanent Sanatana Dharma lifestyle. Very rare. You will not find much. But Prabhupada accomplished that. He actually took the tilak to the West. He took the dhoti to the West. He took the sari to the West. He took the prasadam to the West. What is a typical thing of Jagannath Puri? Jagannath prasad. Where can you get Jagannath prasad? In any of the yoga centers? In any of the Ayurveda centers? Can you get prasad? Can you get kirtan? Yeah, now kirtan movement is slowly coming in by the influence of Shamdas and others. By Vrindavan influence. 100% Vrindavan influence. Neem Karoli Baba. This is how the Kirtan movement started. So, and even though Prabhupada accomplished this, no recognition. Prabhupada is not in the school books. Prabhupada is not, the airport of India is not called Bhaktivedanta Swami Airport. or any airport, or any train station, or any road. They don't even have a Bhaktivedanta Mark. But they have a Max Müller Bhavan and Max Müller this and that. So, there is something is hiding. The national pride of India has not embraced bhakti 100%. You know why? Because they're ashamed, because they're not practicing bhakti. They're ashamed. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada has ashamed them. But I have a feeling that it will come. It will come. It will be I see signs are there that India must discover who was Bhaktivedanta Swami, who is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what is this Bhakti movement all about? What is this Krishna kidnapping Rukmini all about? What is this that everybody's invited to fall in love with the Lord? Look at the story of Jambavati. Jambavati was the daughter of Jambavan. And if I'm not wrong, Jambavan was a kind of a monkey, right? Well, how is he described? Can you remember? King of the monkeys? So, Krishna married Jambavati, the queen, the daughter of the king of the monkeys. What does that mean? It means we have a good chance too. Yes, that's what it means. What do you mean, high class? Nobody said that Jambavan was a sannyasi or he was a Brahmin or he was the king of the monkeys. And Sugriva was another king of the monkey and he became Lord Ram's top general. So the Vedic scriptures, they're not narrow-minded. They are giving great chance to everybody. And what is high class and what is low class? The further away you are from pleasing Krishna, the low class you are. That's what it Varnashrama Vibhaga Shah Shangshidir Hari Tosha. That's why you guys don't get proud. You're just very high class. Not because I want to flatter you, but because you have Tiba Vipra Tiba Nyasi Sudakena Naya, say Krishna Tatvaveta, say Guru Haya. That the Shastras have said. You are very high class. I don't know how I met such high class people like you. Now, the devotee never considers himself high class. He always considers I'm the lowest of the lowest. Like we were discussing the other day with the devotees going into Jagannath Mandir or not going into Jagannath Mandir. I don't want to go into Jagannath Mandir. I'm low class, but I want you to go into Jagannath Mandir because you are high class. That is the understanding. If you first think you are all low class, that's why we are not going. No. We are all seeing the divine plan. And I think there's something going on. May take 10 years, 20 years, 30, 50, who knows how long it'll take. But there'll be a spiritual awakening. And our work in Vrindavan and in Mayapur is part of it. A humble part, insignificant part, or hopefully a big part. At least when it came to these horrible pillars in the Yamuna, that was a big part. Because these horrible pillars and this, ring road plan which they had would have totally devastated Vrindavan and the Kishigad and the whole gods, the divine gods would have been totally devastated. I remember the morning I went there. I'm usually walking the opposite direction because I'm going from Vrindavan Kunja to Yamuna Kunja. And I saw these machines building up this thing there. They did that very fast. Those pillars, they came up within a week or so. Huh? They were real fast. I saw that. I happened there. I looked at it, my jaw dropped. And right there on Keshi, I said, It's pretty crazy, but I said, Krishna, you are the supreme control. If you want the stupid pillars here, if you want to have this gut ruined and have this Vrindavan landmark and sky rise, if you want to have that ruined, you'll get it, because you are supreme controller. But if you ask me, you won't get that. That will not happen. And then we started the protest against the pillars. Then we started making noise, all the things. We went out and picketing right there in the bridges, and then at time, Mayavati sent the order, arrest all the foreigners and deport them who are there. That was the arrest order coming from Lucknow. So that is interesting, no? So at least that part of getting these pillars removed again, we are part of the plan. But we don't want to be part of a negative plan of removing something ugly. We want to be part of a beautifying plan of the creating this Vedic village, Braj Manda, like it is still there. If you go, like for example, we go with our parikrama to Yavat. You know, Kishore Kishore Kunda, Jatila Kutila Mandir. It's a kind of a little village, a lost village somewhere. Pretty dirty, some parts. But still, when the devotees go door to door, then within 20 minutes, they come back with 40 chapatis and aloo parathas and everything, which is, you know, the Brijbasis giving charity to the rich yatris. Because we are rich, we come in with a bus. They don't drive around in buses rented and like that, you know. But they feel so joyful to give madukari. Because they have it so much in their heart. So that beautiful culture is still there, but it's being pushed down. Now we have to push it up, return it. And by doing that, embarrass this whole Delhi society, because Delhi means forgetfulness of the divine tradition. Any big city, you know, but Delhi in particular, because practically Braj Mandala is the garden of Delhi. It's there. Next vacation destination. So let's see what comes from it. Now today, I don't want you to go out. I want you to clean this place to the perfection. You help Bon Maharaj, I don't want one piece of wood flying around, nothing. Paint, where we have to put some oil paint on some of the woods, like this one. Here you see this white stuff, this means we have to take some of these oils and paint them. Also somebody has to cover this new electric line with a bamboo. I don't want to see any plastic thing in this place. So today it's time to work. Make yourself useful. Find something to do. I will personally be here and check on it. I will check. I don't want to see one single thing ugly here. Especially those who have chosen not to go on parikrama today. So we get you here. Don't tourist around today. I have a lot of things to do, and this is also, you know, when there's only 3-4 devotees, they can't do all these things. There's a lot of things. So I have to take advantage of all the hands we have here. Now, with the Dhammanu, if you don't know what to do, get this. I want this Janavi Kunja Goryama to really sparkle and to be. They are doing a very good job. Also, where's Madhusudan Maharaj? We have to finish this Temaskar. It has no door yet. Also, the top is not finished. If it rains, the water will stand there and has to have a top going like this. They didn't finish it.